Welcome you to the third day of SDEVAS 2022 conference in São Paulo that is unfortunately held online. We have here our third invited speaker, Professor Zita Vale. She is a full professor of the Department of Electrical Engineering of the Institute of Engineering Politecnico do Porto. She works in the area of power of energy system, power and energy systems, with special interests in the application of artificial intelligence techniques. She has been involved in more than 60 funded projects related to the development and use of knowledge-based systems, multi-agent systems, neural networks, particle swarm intelligence, and data mining. The main application fields of these projects comprise smart grids, accommodating and intensive use of renewable energy sources, distributed energy resources, namely distributed generation, storage, electrical vehicles, including the ones with gridable capability and demand flexibility. Marco, I'm having echo.
Sorry.
Okay. Real-time management and simulation of energy resources, considering electrical networks, buildings, and diverse Internet of Things, and machine-to-machine approaches are relevant aspects of her work in this field. Electricity markets, addressing decision support for market participants, prices and tariffs, ancillary services, energy transactions, service provision, and market simulation in the scope of wholesale and local markets. The integration of the distributed energy resources, demand response, and electric vehicles in electricity markets, transactive energy, and peer-to-peer approaches are important aspects of her work. Her work also focuses on the conception, development, and test of new business models for market participants and aggregation models for energy resources and the respective management of operation methods. The results of her research are published in more than 200 journal papers. Professor Zita Vale actively participates in several technical working groups and committees, namely from IEEE. Zita Vale is co-editor-in-chief of Applied Energy, which is one of the journals that SDEVAS has a very long cooperation with, and has editing responsibilities in several other journals. She also has regular activity as reviewer and evaluator for papers and for project proposals and monitoring from different funding agencies around the world. Professor Vale, I would like to ask you to take the cloud and present your today lecture in 45 minutes. The cloud is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I thank you very much for your invitation and for introducing me. Good morning, everyone. It's a pity that we have to be in the cloud and not in person, but I will try to give you an insight, a motivating insight of my activities and of the concepts, models, and technological solutions that we have been developing, namely for sustainable energy communities. Just to locate our activities, we are settled in Porto, in Portugal, in our School of Engineering of the Polytechnic of Porto. What you see here is a kind of living lab in a building in ISEP campus. And this building is daily used by researchers, around 20, 30 researchers each day, and is used for testing our solutions. I will first introduced the energy policy in the European Union. In fact, energy is one of the most important topics nowadays on political agendas, on research, on scientific agendas, and on the professional agendas. It's very important because societies need energy to go on. They need energy for economic development. They need energy for their own comfort. And we need to provide people with the required energy, although we should ensure a sustainable use of energy. So this is an important topic inside the European Union. We can say that the European Union is in fact also an energy union. And we are seeing this at the moment because with the current situation, with some problems with the gas supply, we see that energy is more and more understood as a real good that impacts in a very crucial way our lives. So we have very ambitious goals in Europe. Namely, we have goals for climate neutral, which is a very ambitious goal by 2050. And also we have these goals for clean energy for all Europeans. There is a legislation package, which is called good for consumers, good for growth and jobs, and good for the planet. So this clean energy for all Europeans, dealing with the three different aspects, it really can impact our lives and our economy. So let us see how we can take from this starting point, the political willing to solve and to address this problem in an ambitious way and make our work, namely our research work, to contribute to fulfill these goals. We can also look at other international entities and other international agreements. Of course, the world is much larger than Europe. You know that Europe is not rich in energy terms, and there are many areas around the world, namely Brazil, who are much richer than Europe. So, on the other hand, it is not possible to divide the world into different countries when it comes to energy and when it comes to climate, environment. So it is important that we have very large agreements involving the all possible countries that can contribute to this energy sustainability. And in that frame, we have, of course, United Nations, who have been working towards this goal. We have the Paris 2015 agreement. We have regular meetings around this subject, not always with the best possible agreements, but nevertheless with the possible agreements that are helping us to go on and to go on with the best solutions. So I will talk a little bit about energy in these times. And these times are times that we are addressing smart grids and microgrids. Smart grids is a very generic concept, but it is a very important one. Microgrids, on the other hand, are a very, very concrete implementation, a physical implementation that is very important for smart grids. And inside this concept of smart grids, we have a lot of building blocks. Namely, we have to consider renewables, of course, distributed generation, generation that is based on primary sources, which are renewable energy sources. We have to consider storage, because storage is difficult when it comes to power systems. We always have a very low percentage of storage in power systems due to technological, but mostly to economic reasons. And now storage is being used more widely, not only at the utility scale, but also at distributed level. And also we should consider electric vehicles. We know that there are a lot of decisions regarding vehicles and that in some years electric vehicles will have a very strong presence in our roads and in our streets. And finally, we should, of course, consider buildings because most of the time people are inside buildings and a lot of energy is used inside buildings. So buildings are a very relevant building block for the success of smart grids. So we have to consider active consumers because the consumers that are inside these buildings or somewhere else, they should be aware of the use of energy. Also, we should consider aggregation because we are talking here about distributed energy resources. It is important that we are able somehow to aggregate them in order to gain some scale and to be able to come up with good business and technical solutions. Finally, at the end of the day, we need to ensure sustainable systems, but sustainable systems in different aspects. Of course, in the energy aspect, but also in the environment aspect and in the economic aspect. Our goals. Our goals, as always, are to reduce costs, to increase the profits, and of course, we want in this way to ensure a relevant added value. And with this added value, we must know what to do with it. And maybe the most difficult question to be answered right now is how we should distribute and share this value. In the look for replies, we should look not only at the energy transactions, but also we should look at the energy provision. Because power and energy systems require a lot of energy-related service that must be ensured for the efficiency and security of the system itself. We must also look at business models because this must be sustainable in a market-driven approach. In fact, right now, we should look at the problem not only at as a problem which impacts all public life and all people life, but also a problem that should be solved doing the best possible actions and based on market-driven models. So we should look at contracts, tariffs, and so on to go on with the models that are able to help us to achieve our energy goals. And for that, energy consumers, but also energy communities are very relevant. In fact, I believe that we cannot work at the distributed level, at the local level, without organizing some kind of energy communities. Why? Because people are having much more impact on the energy systems than before. Before, the energy systems were mostly centralized. So decisions were centralized. So the utilities could use their own human resources, their own financial resources, their know-how to solve the problems. But now the people's action have a lot of impact on the energy and power systems. And this is why people are so important. And sometimes we have a huge difficulty in considering the models that are related with people. People are seen as citizens when it comes to smart cities, as customers for retailers in energy, as consumers for utilities. But in fact, retailers, utilities, people working in the power and energy field are not used to conceive good models to address people's behavior and the impact of people on the system. We must address demand flexibility, we must address demand response, this meaning the way in which the demand flexibility can be delivered to the system or to third parties. we must consider local generation, local storage, electrical vehicles, and all the distributed energy resources. And in fact, communities are already considered important in the European legislation. I have here some text from two different directives, one directive from 2018, the other from 2019, both addressing energy communities. In one case, they are called renewable energy communities because renewable resources are very important. In the other case, they are called citizen energy communities because this aspect of people being citizens is so important too. In any case, if you look at the European directives, what we can see is that they are quite ambitious. I must say that in 2019, when I saw this directive 944, I was quite pleased because in fact, it shows that we can now go on, we can go forward and apply many of the models that are really helpful to ensure sustainability. So, let us consider these communities, consider the local generation that is based on renewables, consider also the self-consumption. Consumer self-consumption was not a reality till some years ago. It was not considered legal in many countries. Now it is being considered not only legal, but very useful. So we should work with it. We should work with demand flexibility and demand response. We should consider pair-to-pair transactions, transactions among neighbors, and of course, different kinds of organizations, namely local energy markets. So we have new opportunities. We have the opportunity to share of our resources, noting that sharing does not mean sharing for free. We can still have benefits for the sharing of our results. We should consider these pair-to-pair transactions. We should consider transactive energy and new organizations and markets, namely the aggregators, local markets, and energy communities. And of course, we are having a lot of operation data coming from the new players and new organizations. And we should study and have solutions for the good application and good use of those data. So I would say that we need real-time decision and action because we should keep the lights on. The physical system is still there. The physical system, I mean the electric grids, all the substations, they are the basic support for all this power and energy business. So we should consider the physical models of the infrastructure we have, and we should ensure the real-time decision and action to keep our system operating in an efficient and secure way. So we need real-time power system analysis, we need real-time simulation, of course, and we need real-time decision support. Don't forget that now the utilities, the large utilities, are not alone taking decisions. We need distributed decision making. And of course, we need data-driven methods. For that, we need historic data. We will use also real-time data and, of course, machine learning, different methods for machine learning. And one important question is, what are the requirements to use these data-driven methods to support the players and markets activities? Sometimes we focus a lot on the methods, but we forget that they are to be used in practice. And if this application has to be successful, we have to look at the requirements for their use. So, in the frame of this legislation, namely for Directive 944, We need to give very concrete replies to this question. And maybe we can have two different questions that are also very important. We should ask ourselves how to use data-driven methods to contribute to the advancements, and how to use the results obtained with those data-driven methods to contribute to the advancements we want to ensure, or we must to ensure. To give replies to these problems, we have been working in different models, new methods, and to test all these models and methods, we felt the need to have a very good infrastructure for real-time simulation and management for power and energy systems. And we have been developing this MARTIN platform, which is based on multi-agent systems. I can divide this platform into four different levels. The first level in the bottom is the real-time simulation level. For that, we use our algorithms, but all we know the difficulties around real-time simulation in power and energy. So we also use a professional platform for that, namely, in our case, two different systems from Opal RT. And then we have the real world, the physical world. And the next layer includes everything in this physical world we live in, namely all the buildings, all the equipment, and of course, all the gateways and all the communication means that we have. And the third level is the level for multi-agent systems. We found that multi-agent systems were the best approach to have our models and our algorithms, and we are using multi-agent based platforms. And finally, the top level is the level for the intelligent applications and services. This is the image for our living lab. In fact, I always say that you are invited to visit us, to discuss with us our solutions. But when I look at this photo, I must confess that it looks much better than in reality. So don't be disappointed when you come here. It's not maybe so nice as this picture, not so green, because this is maybe the greener part of ISAP campus. But in fact, this is a very good building for testing these solutions. Also, some pictures of equipment that we are using. Mostly, we are using equipment bought from the shelf, equipment which is used in real buildings, in real industries that we can buy. Simply, we are adapting this equipment to our needs. So we have a lot of work adapting the equipment and also to make it for our use in the simulation, because we want to control our equipment using our software. And this usually is not possible when we buy from shelf, off-the-shelf equipment. So the most important topic of our research is about artificial intelligence models for power and energy systems. And of course, there are a lot of models, a lot of applications of AI in power and energy these days, a lot of papers in the literature, some books also. But if we look at all the possibilities in the artificial intelligence world, we see that power and energy systems are taking benefits from only a small part of those possibilities. Namely, currently, we have quite a good number of optimization and computational intelligence applications and models. Also, machine learning is being widely used, as well as knowledge discovery. But when we look at user modeling, when we look at semantics, ontologies, ambient intelligence, expert systems, cyber physical systems, context awareness, taking benefit of all these AI possibilities, I must say that power and energy systems are not taking the good advantage of all these concepts and models and methods. So we are working in some of these areas. For that, of course, we need funding, we need partnerships, because it's important, a multidisciplinary approach. And in Look for Replies, we have been involved in more than 60 projects in the past 5 years, different kinds of projects, mostly European-funded projects, but also national projects and projects with partners outside the European area. And it's, of course, very important to have partnership with academic partners. It's the basic of our network, but also it's very important to have companies and the industry inside these projects, because like that we can deal with the actual problems of the industry, of the companies, and test our solutions for real world problems. So, coming back to Martin, Martin is about multi-agent simulation and multi-agent management of energy resources in real time. What we have inside is, of course, the consideration of the electricity market, all forms of electricity market. Also, we need to model the aggregator, the operator, physical resources, and have some simulated players, which we do not have at each time present in our building, for instance, in our experiment. And on the other side, we have all the other aspects, namely demand response, optimization, the contracts, the context, decision support, and so on. And what is really important is this part in the button of this slide. Because, of course, we must have learning if our systems are intelligent and if they are automated, if they are taking decision by themselves, they must learn over time. Also, they must be contextual, because a decision that is very relevant and very intelligent in one context may be very bad in other contexts, because the context is very different. So this is very important, and we have learned this over years. We have always contextual approaches. And this TUI that I have here, this module, is also very important. This model refers to the management of efficiency and effectiveness, because the efficiency and effectiveness are both very important, but when it comes to real-time operation, I must manage them in the best possible way so that I provide the best possible solution considering the time constraints I'm facing. What we do is that we have a selection of alternatives, different algorithms that can address the same problem. And in fact, with this module, this management model, we can choose the best possible algorithm, the best possible approach in the frame of each context that we are facing. Another view of our platforms. In this case, what I must refer is that one single multi-agent system is not enough to address this very distributed problem, because this is a very complex problem, a very dynamic problem with highly distributed nature. So we need a set of multi-agent systems. And one problem we started having and feeling was the interaction of these systems among themselves. So we needed to study and to have new models for the interaction of multi-agent systems with the concept of a multi-agent system society. And going on with this concept, we should evolve. And in fact, we realized that the existing models for multi-agent systems are not the best one and do not suit our needs for this environment, this new environment in power and energy systems. We need dynamic agents, but also a dynamic approach for these agents to be part of the multi-agent system. So we are also working on this new approach and this new model for agent-based ecosystem framework for smart grid, supporting all these new concepts. For instance, when one player is inside one community and this community is part of an aggregator, they are using services, external services, and they want to be taking the best opportunity to fulfill their needs with those services. So it's very likely that they want to change the provider of one or other service. And maybe it's also likely that from time to time, they want to change to a different aggregator or even to a different community. And we are working on the concepts and on the models, the energy models, but also the informatic models that give support to do all these dynamic changes in real time without losing efficiency or security of the system, of course. This is just an example for a problem where I have retailers, the traditional energy, electric energy retailers, and also I have aggregators. So I can model this with a set of agents. As you can see here, I have my retailers. In this case, the retailers are considered as clients of these services. Then I have my different players here. I have service agents from which the other players can take service, the external services I was mentioning before. And even I can have agents that are not in the frame of a multi-agent system. They can cooperate with one multi-agent system, with several multi-agent systems, but they are agents which are independent from the existing multi-agent systems. And all these models must be coherent. They must be driven by the goals of their owners, let's say, because each consumer, each community, each aggregator should be modeled according to their own goals and also to their own constraints, but they should be able to work together. So this is a problem in which the different players should, on one hand, fulfill their goals and compete with the other players, but on the other hand, they must somehow cooperate because in fact they are interrelated, and if they do not cooperate, the whole system will be broken and at that time the lights will go off. Okay, one important aspect is about semantics. I guess that you have already heard about interoperability. Interoperability is currently considered as a very important topic in power and energy. And the reason for this is quite simple. Traditionally, we had a small set of large utilities in the system, and they ensured most of the needs we had. But right now, we have a set of large utilities still there, but also we have a large, very large set of small or medium-sized players that are also involved in this system. And they are involved not only as passive players, but as active players. They are contributing to the operation of the system, meaning that they have maybe a positive contribution, and this is good, but maybe they have a negative contribution and they can harm the operation, the good operation of the system. So now that we have a large set of players, they are working with many different components, equipment, and systems. And all these pieces must work together. That's why interoperability is so important. But interoperability normally is understood at the level of physical interoperability or communication interoperability. And to put everything working together, in fact, we need to go further. And this is about semantics. The different components, the different systems, the different algorithms must somehow understand the concepts that the other systems, the other components, the other equipment are using. And that's why in the last 5 or 6 years, we are working on semantics for real-time operation. Previously, we have been working on semantics and ontologies for electricity markets, but not for real-time operation. Now we are working on it for real-time operation. You can see that we have here the physical world, let's say, in this case, several RTUs, and we have a semantic converter. We have, of course, a knowledge model, a knowledge base with our semantic model. Then we have an engine, just it is a different kind of engine, not a physical one, but it's a semantic engine, an inference engine that deals with all this knowledge. And finally, we can issue notifications. We can issue alarms, but also we can also have automated operation and control. And this is very important because this is making easier not only the operation of the systems, of the buildings, but also the development of the solutions. This is an aspect of our internal system, completely developed, in-house developed, so it is not a bought system, just the pieces have been bought by us, and we do a lot of different things with this system. This system accommodates different algorithms. We are very often changing the algorithms because we want to test them, but the system itself is able to undertake the real-time management of the building. Here I see roughly half of that building, and we have a nice system that is based on wall boards, but also can be based on the management then in our laptops, in our mobile phones, in our tablets, and so on. So it's quite flexible, and it is being daily used by the people working on this building. This is an aspect of one of the control pages. You can see that we call it click to control, C2C, and we can define preferences, then we can act in on the system, lights, air conditioning, doors, not only energy, so we also have the control over doors, some physical security topics, and also we have permissions, of course, and users only can access and act on the rooms and on the equipment when they have the right permission to do so. These are some examples of our development. Of course, we work with some hardware. We don't develop so much in terms of hardware, but we have developed, in this case, yet another smart plug. You know that there are a lot of smart plugs in the market these days, but our smart plug is a little bit different because it is intended to work with agents, with multi-agent systems, to be aware of the context and to be aware of other equipments in the same area. This is an aspect of the board in one of our walls. Also here it is a touch panel and you can control almost everything depending on the permissions you have. For instance, here if I click, this is the control for the doors to make sure that the door will be open when I arrive in my room or the meeting room, for instance. I'd like also to say that, of course, we have some research opportunities at our labs, at our research center. So if you are interested, please contact me. And every year we recruit a lot of master and PhD students and also people already having a PhD. Also, I would like to call your attention to the need that we have to have access to open data sets. This is important. I am involved in several working groups in IEEE. We have been taking this problem very seriously, making efforts. So please use our public data sets. I believe it's worth to use them. And also, please feel free to contribute. It's very good if you can contribute with some additional open data sets that can be used by the community. This is important not only in academic, but in professional terms. Also, we are taking some organizing some worldwide competitions. So if you are interested, please take a look at our site. Right now, we have an open deadline for the end of October, meaning that you can compete if you are interested, you can disseminate it to your colleagues. This competition in particular is related with solar generation forecasting with real data. We have also other competitions, namely in the computational intelligence domain with evolutionary computation. Right now, we have no open competitions because they have just closed and the winners have been announced in the previous week. But we are going to have new editions because we run new editions each year. I will go on with this, just a brief reference to the need to consider real data, for instance, for energy tariffs, to study very attentively what happens with these tariffs. In this case, this is an implementation in our building, considering five different players. We consider that the building is owned by one of these players and that this building has office rooms that are rented by other players, by companies, for instance, or by professionals. And we have some shared photovoltaic generation panels in the rooftop. So we made some experimentation, not only computational, but physical experimentation with the sharing of the generation of these panels. And very briefly, we used different kinds of auctions in this market. We used the physical implementation that I showed you before in a photo when I showed our equipment with single board computers. And in fact, this implementation really shows that for different scenarios, you can see here very different scenarios, we can in fact have significant advantage when taking these new opportunities for communities, for resource sharing, for peer-to-peer transactions, for local electricity markets. So these are the average prices, and they are compared with the difference between demand and supply. Of course, if the community is able to have higher supply, it will be more comfortable for this community to manage the energy resources, and the prices can in fact be impacted and can be lower than the prices provided by a traditional retailer. So I thank you very much for your attention. And of course, I'm available for some discussion if you want to do so. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Valle. I'm opening now cloud for discussion. You can place your questions under question and answers, or you can put them in chat. We already have two questions. One is from Vladimir. He asks, could you please share your thoughts on how the notion of fairness in energy communities or lack thereof will impact their success? Where do you see fairness to be most important? Virtual net billing, energy sharing, entry exit clauses of members, etc.
This is in fact a very, very relevant question. I had no time to address this topic, but this is a topic we are very much interested to, and we are working in this topic. Thank you for the question. Fairness is very important when we come to a distributed approach, because now the solution really impacts each of the players, and I can say when it comes to communities, each of the consumers. And the problem is that models that are traditionally used, for instance, optimization models, but also the new machine learning models are not correctly dealing with optimization. And one of the problems I have been seeing in the past few years is that people, most of the times, are addressing communities, aggregators, all these kinds of distributed organizations with the same models they were using for to address the centralized organizations, which are the traditional organizations in power and energy system. And this is not possible. So it's very important to ensure fairness. For instance, when it comes to a community, when consumers are invited to develop strategies to have their flexibility, their demand flexibility delivered to the whole community, or even deliver to the aggregator or to the distribution system operator, the fairness in gaining some benefit must be ensured. So optimization cannot be applied in the old way, I would say. For instance, there are different kinds of approach. You can have an historic approach, registering all the benefits that each player is having a long time, and then considering in the optimization this historic. Also, you can, inside the algorithms, put additional strategies to consider the fairness. And fairness comes together with some kind of reputation, because we must consider not only the fairness, but also the reputation of each individual or each community. So this is important inside the community. This is important among communities. This is important among aggregators and so on. So in fact, there are already some strategies for that. In summary, these two kinds of strategy outside the algorithms, with additional algorithms that rely on the historic registration of all the contributions and benefits, or inside the algorithms with changes in the algorithms themselves to consider this topic.
Thank you. The next question is coming from Shir Kilkish. Thank you for this valuable lecture. How should sustainable energy communities better interact with the broader energy system to increase demand flexibility and demand response options beyond the power sector? For example, the info kit for the European Mission on Climate Neutral Cities by 2030, with 112 cities selected, recently emphasizes cities have multiple opportunities for harnessing a wider range of renewable heat and cold source in the local context in an efficient and flexible way as a means of increasing renewable energy deployment and deepening the process of energy system integration. Can agents in Martin also have the opportunity of engaging in power to X options with the heat sector?
Yes, yes. This is another very, very important topic because in fact, energy itself and electrical energy are not alone. We should take advantage of all possible interconnections, all possible uses between the different forms of energy, so heat, cold, and electrical energy. Although I must say that we are seeing the electrification of everything, almost everything, because you see now that even heating and cooling is coming more and more electric based. Vehicles, transportation, I'm not just talking about small vehicles, but about buses, for instance, they are coming to the electric fields also. So we are assisting to the electrification of different sectors. Nevertheless, it's very important to consider the interaction of all those forms, all the existing forms of energy, and we should be taking advantage of that. Also, we should take advantage and consider energy and the other resources, namely water, for instance, the nexus between energy and water, the nexus between energy, water, and food, because food can also contribute to the sustainability or non-sustainability of communities, of cities, and also transportation, because transportation is not only about energy, electric or non-electric energy, transportation is about organization, about the time we spend when traveling and so on. So it's about the organization of the community and of the city. So my reply is definitively yes. It's very important to consider all these interrelations. It's very important that our models do not only consider a part of the problem. Martin is able to accommodate these models. In GECAD, we are mostly working on the electric energy part because it's where we have the most know-how, but also we have some work about heating and we have some work about physical security and also about, as I mentioned, about mobility. So all kinds of transportation and mobility. But Martin does not only accommodate our models. In several projects, one of the best advantages of this infrastructure is that in several projects, Martin has served to accommodate the algorithms of our partners, because it is sufficiently open to work with remote data and remote algorithms. And in that frame, Martin has already worked with different approaches for managing heating and cooling resources together with the other resources.
Thank you. One of the ways that we think, I'm more from the energy planning side, so I see clearly that smart grids are coming. We will need a lot of them. But the question is how to move it forward, not technologically, but from the point of view of business model. You need to have some signal that would signal the users when to spend more electricity and when to spend less electricity. There are several approaches, but what I think it's a reasonable solution for Europe is to use the price as a signal. So we are already starting slowly to link wholesale price and retail price. And this could serve as a good signaling. But now we have a following situation in which wholesale prices are extremely high most of the day because the marginal electricity is coming from gas, and we have a crisis, and we see that there is a lot of pressure against the current marginal cost-based electricity markets, which would serve us well, but we also have to be very careful not to allow social problems by linking this electricity to homes. How do you see this coming out in a few years' time? Are we going to have a more reasonable price? Because what we need is actually a low price when there is a lot of electricity, so we use power for heating and charging electric cars at home, and a high price when there is not enough renewables, so we save on electricity. But how does it develop in the next 5 years, let's say?
Thank you. It's in fact a very complex, but also a very important matter. Thank you for the question. I must say that today we are not yet at a stage where old players are comfortable in their roles. I must say that the energy communities, and this was the topic for my talk today, I believe they are very important for the current and future needs when it comes to energy. But the interaction between the traditional players and the new players is not yet clear, of course. And all of them are looking for the opportunities. I must say that I see some very reputed and large utilities with a very intelligent approach to that. So they are looking at the advantage they can have, but accepting that in fact future is not like the past, and that if we want to fulfill the energy goals we have to make changes. So this is what I call an intelligent utility, because they are facing the changes. When it comes to the contribution of this distributed player, namely consumers, there are two approaches when it comes to electricity or even to other forms of energy, which is an implicit approach to demand response, changing prices. And of course, we have to deal with those social issues. We must take care about how to change prices, how it impacts people and the industry and the economy and so on. But this is the implicit way of demand response. And then we have the explicit way of delivering the flexibility, the explicit demand response, dealing with demand response events. Events that are declared, and people know that in a certain period, it's good that they increase or decrease their consumption. And of course, there are a lot of complex issues there. But one, I believe that it is very important to come up with good, efficient, but cheap solutions which are automated, because most people don't have the time during the day to pay attention to calls, to these calls. And sometimes these calls must be done with only a small anticipation. So we only have a small period to react. So it is very important to have automated, intelligent solutions. And it is also very important to have simple solutions, simple business models. When we work with communities, and we had a project, a demonstration project in Portugal, in three small cities. And we learned that sometimes we have to put apart our complex mathematical models and to come up with very simple models for demand response, models that people can really understand. If I contribute like this, I will benefit like that. So I believe that this work on business models, namely when it comes to small communities and to individual players and families, it's very important. It has to be done. And we have to find innovative approaches. For instance, in that case, we had an aggregator in the project, and we worked on a new kind of tariff that were put in place when people contributed positively with demand response. So the community had benefits, and then the tariffs would benefit the particular consumers that had those contributions.
Thank you very much. And with this, I would like to thank you for your excellent lecture.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Muito obrigado.
Obrigada.
Now we are moving forward. I would like to ask Professor Karen Mascarenhas to take over chairing the session and start with the panel.